Good evening. Thank you all very much for coming. I assume that many of you had a long night last night, so it's nice that you could even come for an evening event tonight. I want to thank, first of all, Elizabeth Ulig and the organizing committee for arranging for Dr. Mukherjee to come here tonight and for casting a broad net in terms of inviting people from School of Medicine, School of Nursing, School of Public Health. I'm Roy Ziegelstein. I'm the Vice Dean for Education in the School of Medicine, and it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Mukherjee. Dr. Mukherjee is an Associate Professor of Medicine, as you can see, in the Division of Global Health Equity and the Department of Medicine at the Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. Her real area is the provision of health as a human right, and she works a lot, as you'll hear, in the developing world and in countries outside of the United States. She does a lot of teaching, she interacts with a lot of trainees, she does a lot of clinical care. And I think that we were just talking briefly a minute ago, that the timing of her talk tonight, in light of the election last night and the results, is curious at best, perhaps, and I think very timely, so that instead of focusing on the developing world, perhaps a large amount of her conversation tonight will focus on the United States and on health and other issues here in this country. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Mukherjee.
I want to really thank Elizabeth and the team for inviting me here and the patience and many schedule changes. I have a friend who is an undergrad, so I wanted to work with her schedule too, and she's right here in the middle of it. The title of the talk that you have in front of you is about universal health coverage. I'm not going to talk much about domestic healthcare because it's something that I really am not at all expert on, and I know you have many, many experts here on domestic issues. But what I realized late last night, at 3:30 in the morning, is that it was not really possible to give a straight up academic talk after that election shocker. I thought that would be, for me personally, hard, and for you as listeners, really kind of tone deaf to how many of you are probably feeling. So what I want to do is just take a few minutes. I will get to some of the aspects of universal health coverage. Some of you are probably interested in what's happening around the world, but I wanted to reflect a little bit on our own profession, on how this happened, on what we as health professionals might do about it. I think all of us here are here because we want to help others. That puts us in a very important group of people as the world changes. And so that's what I'm going to talk about a little. This is a slide from some of my medical students. Danica Berry from Harvard Medical School shared this with me. It is a 6-minute journey from Roxbury Crossing to Back Bay Station. And for those of you who know Boston, these are very different worlds in that 6-minute journey between Roxbury Crossing and Back Bay. And this is the disparity in life expectancy between Roxbury and Back Bay. It's shocking. It's a 33-year difference in life expectancy for a 6-minute train ride. Zip code is a far more important indicator of your health than any behavior, than any culture, than any genetics. Zip code. Zip code is what determined the election. Zip code. We are missing this as a profession. Many schools of public health, like mine, are right in Roxbury. Many schools of public health, like yours, are right in areas that have the lowest life expectancy. the highest rates of morbidity. And we are somehow immune to that as professionals. We have made our work as health professionals about us and them. And I am, like your dean, I'm an educator. And I believe deeply that we need to fundamentally change our pedagogy of how we teach and work together to better humanity. If we constantly are the experts imparting our knowledge on ignorant masses, we will fail to develop the humanity that it will take to breed resilience across the communities that elected our next president. They are neglected people. And yes, we hear racist sentiment, misogynist sentiment, we hear many terrible things, but there is underneath that pain. There is underneath that a lack of understanding or empathy from the elites, and we are the elites, guys. And we have to figure out a way to bridge that six minute train ride from Roxbury to Back Bay. How did we get here? I'm just going to dissect and attack our own profession. I am a medical professional. I'm also trained in public health. I'm going to critique a little bit our own profession and then try to talk a little bit about the way forward and how we may together think about a pedagogy and teaching and working together to bridge that painful divide. Okay? One is the politics of disease control. Public health was started by who? Who's the father of public health? Not the mother, of course, the father. Who's the father of public health? John Snow, right? What did John Snow do? He did what? He discovered a cholera outbreak came from where? A water source, a water source. He mapped it, right? This is shoe leather public health. This is what all of you are trained to do, right? He found that cholera was coming from one pump, the Broad Street pump. And what did he do? He took the handle off of that pump. He's a hero. He's lionized. He has schools of public health organizations named after him. If you are a mother who seeks water from the Broad Street pump, how do you feel about John Snow? Not great, because you still need your water. If your husband, or your wife in this case, because the women got cholera much more often than the men, just as a side story, because the men were working in breweries and they drank a tankard of ale instead of the water, so they didn't get cholera because it was pasteurized, but anyway. So if your wife was sickened with cholera and you knew John Snow had a treatment, which he didn't at that time, and all he did was take the handle off the pump, what would you think? Not a hero, not enough, right? So while John Snow is a hero, right, the politics of disease control remove us from proximity of suffering. Control the disease, and you're done. But you don't deal with what we call the social determinants of disease. Where are these people going to get their water, right? How do I understand the needs of this family? How can I weigh in? Because maybe it's about trying to put another water. Not just take that handle. And the politics of disease control are always with us. Protect the greater. And kind of, well, not worry too much about the impact of that. And I was never more horrified by that than during Ebola. Partners in Health waded into the Ebola crisis in Sierra Leone and Liberia, and the politics of disease control, and this is a picture, I think it was from Time magazine, this is not a picture of ours, of a woman being dragged, she had symptoms of Ebola, and she is being dragged by people in spacesuits to be locked up in a holding cell so that she does not contaminate others. What does that do to our humanity? These are decent, dignified people. I am quite sure the people in spacesuits, I am sure they were trying to do the right thing. Okay, but they are impervious to the suffering in that moment. The politics of disease control have removed us from proximity to the suffering. We cannot control disease without understanding the social forces. You know, we call them, as educators, we call them the social determinants of disease. I'm trying to change that. Determinants sound very fixed to me. I want to call them the social forces. These are active forces of racism, of oppression, of resource extraction. These are not fixed things. Look at what's happening in North Dakota with the pipeline. That is not a social determinant that Native Americans are going to have a pipeline go through their sacred land. That is an active force of corporations and profit, right? And fossil fuels, those are forces. And so we have to look at our job. At least let's take one thing, disease control. Do not practice disease control without understanding what community needs, without deeply listening to people, without walking together with them and see, is it even their priority? Many of you know about the difficulty with ending polio. And there are communities, particularly in northern Nigeria, that have refused the polio virus vaccine. And people say, oh, they're just ignorant. Or they're clerics, right? They're Muslim people. They don't believe in vaccines. When you unpack this, and I have done this with friends of mine who are Nigerian, who work in this, they say, we actually don't care about this one polio drop. We need a clinic. We don't care about this. We need a well. So it's not like they're ignorant, they don't understand polio. They don't understand your single disease infectious control, you know, disease control priority. And most of our profession is built on disease control priorities, my friends. So we've got to put humanity and social forces in that. Exaggerating culture. We are all guilty of this. We say, well, you know, this is another picture from the Ebola time, bushmeat. Tell people not to eat bushmeat. Because they love their bushmeat, they do in Liberia. Well, I don't know how many of you have gone to a fancy restaurant and had quail, right? That's bushmeat, right? Free-range chicken, that's approaching bushmeat, right? It's meat. It's meat. It happens to be from the bush, right? And when you start to tell people don't eat bushmeat, first of all, it's wrong because there was one case of Ebola out of 28,000 that was perhaps transmitted by poorly cooked meat. We don't even know. And every other case, 99.999 of the rest of the cases were human to human. So telling people not to eat bushmeat is wrong, one. Two, that is their protein source. So if you close the bushmeat markets, which happened, then people are out of jobs and children are out of protein, right? So these are ways we exaggerate culture. We're gonna tell people not to eat bushmeat. No alternative, no discussion, no what do you think, right? And the same was true with funerals. You don't understand. Like this guy from CDC said to me, you don't understand, Joy. These West African funerals, they touch the dead people. I said, really? Well, it turns out I'm Irish, right? In an Irish wake, you actually take the person out of the casket and you put a beer in their hand. I mean, if we had Ebola, like if my great-grandpa had Ebola, we'd all have had Ebola. Everybody touches dead people. That's what we do. We're human beings. This is not some West African weird thing. Why do we exoticize culture? I believe it's because it lets us off the hook. Because then we can put the blame on the behavior of the person rather than the systems that we together need to set up. These are moral failings, and I believe these are happening over and over again in America. Those Trump people, we don't know who they are. We're not asking them where their pain is. Some of the people have been unemployed now for 10 years, 15 years, lost their good union wage jobs, haven't taken a vacation in, you know, 7, 8 years, lost their home, their wife left them, and yeah, they're voting for Trump, but we're not listening. We're saying, well, it's a kind of a culture. It's a white rural culture. Like, let's listen. Let's say, what is going on? Where is your pain? We're not doing that as professionals. So we need to do that, at least in our own profession. And then we create these fictitious, I believe very fictitious, intellectual arguments about behavior. So one is this idea of demand creation, and you'll hear a lot about this in public health. This clinic in Rinkwavu, Rwanda is underutilized because people don't have demand. So our job is going to be, again, doing education campaigns, posters, and telling people, come forward because you can get health services. Because we're saying it's their ignorance, not our delivery, that's causing the underutilization of services. So our information, education, communication campaign is to create demand. Healthcare is good. Come forward. Having your baby in the hospital is a good thing. It's best for mom and baby. Come forward. You see posters like this all over. Millions of dollars of posters to drive people to a facility that looks like this. That's fundamentally irresponsible. Right? If you're pregnant in labor and hemorrhaging, you go to a facility like this, you're going to die. And I've seen that. But we are mistaking demand with supply. We're mistaking the lack of utilization with people not wanting health care. And oh, so they're going to voodoo healers and stuff. This is Plebo, Liberia, one of the worst health centers that I've ever seen. They say the reason women don't deliver in this facility, this does not do justice to the haunted house nature of this facility. It's a horrible, horrible place. And the providers told me the reason women don't go is because they prefer going to traditional healers. So I go into the facility, and in the back, and there's like literally rats and roaches and molded ceiling panels and water coming. It's in a rainforest. Right? It's in a rainforest. And you can see the sky, and there's a delivery table, and it's broken, and it's dirty. And I said to the nurse, does anyone actually deliver a baby there? She says, sometimes, if they're really in trouble. And I looked up, and I can see the sky, and I say, what do you do if it rains? And she said, oh, wait. She leaves, she comes back, and she says, we have this umbrella. Okay, this is not about demand. This is actually smart thinking that women wouldn't want to deliver in a place like that. So we have to be intellectually honest about otherizing people who are poor, who are suffering, who are marginalized, and say, what is the role that our rhetoric plays in that? We have to build systems that work for people, whether they're education systems, health systems. We cannot keep blaming the victims of unemployment, the victims of losing jobs, the victims of lack of health care with their own behavior or culture. And we, frankly, are teaching you guys to do that. We've got to stop. Got to stop. And then the last thing I would say is we have to not exaggerate the crushing impact of poverty, or not underestimate the crushing impact of poverty. Every time I see a person with tuberculosis, the first question I ask is, how many people live in your house? And I see a lot of tuberculosis, like half of what I do, right? How many people live in your house? And usually the answer is like 10. How many rooms do you have in their house? And usually the answer is 1 or 2. Imagine what that would be like. Like, we have to try to figure out how do people even manage to live in such undignified, unjust, overcrowded environments. This is a house. This is a house of a child in Haiti who had tuberculosis, a child, and treated the child. She started doing better, and we walked with him, to his house. And there were 10 people living in that house. And they all had tuberculosis, right? So is the problem tuberculosis? Or is the problem this, like, literally abject poverty? And if we don't address the abject poverty as a social force, as a social creation, then we're never going to really succeed at anything. And then the last thing is exaggerating agency. And I think most of you probably are familiar with the term agency, but I'll just recap for a second, which is really, it's the ability that you have to carry something out. In other words, what are the tools you have? You may have the knowledge, but do you have the tools? And the classic example that Habermas uses to describe agency is, let's say you have legs and you could ride a bicycle, but you don't have the bicycle, right? So you can't ever learn to ride a bicycle, right? Agency is like that. The choices that you make are just confined or not by your circumstances. We tend to, as public health and health professionals, exaggerate people's agency. So we give them knowledge, but we don't look at the environment in which they're using knowledge. And I'll give you a specific story about malnutrition. Many of you may have done a program that's well known as GOBI, growth monitoring, oral rehydration, breastfeeding, and immunization. The idea was to use these simple things that are mostly preventive and mostly educational to improve under five child survival. And the classic thing is you put a kid on a growth chart and you monitor their growth. And when they're failing to grow, you educate the mom. And you say there are four food groups. Here they are. You have a nice poster like this. I had this. I did this, right? And many of you have done this. You shouldn't do it. Just saying. I think it's a really tone-deaf thing to do. I'm using that word too much. But so you say, okay, these are your four food groups. They're meat, they're bread, they're fruits and vegetables, they're like fat or whatever. Your child needs more chicken legs. And kids might be swollen, red hair, big belly. We call it malnutrition. I have started to call that not malnutrition, that is starvation. These are children that are starving, and we are taught to teach their mothers what to feed them. I mean, it's absurd. And if you go with the moms, which I do now, but I didn't when I first was taught to do this, I would say, it's just that they don't understand what foods to give their babies. But any mother, when you give that education, they just look at you like, you're a fool, right? Or they feel humiliated because every mother wants to feed her baby. Every mother wants to do the right thing for her kid. And now I have the privilege at Partners in Health, I can actually go to the homes with the moms, right? See what's going on, and you see they have absolutely no assets, absolutely no food, absolutely no land. So you're just saying, give more chicken legs. They have no food. So we're exaggerating the agency of this mother, right, to take this information and use it to feed her kid because she doesn't have the thing that she needs, right? And a lot of public health programs are exaggerating culture, exaggerating agency, underestimating poverty, underestimating the politics of disease control and its impact on people. So what does this have to do with the election? I think we have, I'm trying to say, what did I do wrong, right? What did we do wrong? I think we have created a society, and we're teaching it at elite institutions like this one and like mine, for people to feel that they're so expert and they have this knowledge and they're going to impart it to these lowly masses of ignorant people. I believe in a different kind of pedagogy as an educator. I believe in a pedagogy which some call Freirean pedagogy. Paulo Freire was a Brazilian educator. He worked to teach Brazilian peasants how to read. And what he realized is he was just teaching them letters, teaching them words. And he was banking his knowledge in the heads of these lowly and oppressed people and recreating this pedagogic structure where he is the master and they are the slave. And he said, no, education should be liberating for both parties, liberating us from this bizarre place we are, where we're sitting in an ivory tower, liberating those who are hearing it from their oppression. And so he created a pedagogy where he talks about shared mastery. And I talked with some of our students earlier about how I do this. We have a lot of community health workers across PIH who are peasant farmers. And And we start with just drawing a line and say, this is a field. How do you feed yourself? And the discussion becomes very rich, and people say, well, we plant seeds here, and the rows are this far apart, and we wait for these rains, and we do this for fertilizer, and it's very animated. And then I can say, okay, we have a problem with starvation here. You need to help me understand what's going on. Do we have a virus in the cassava crop? Is there not enough rain? What inputs might we help you with, right? And I can give you some medical knowledge about treatment, about what we need to do for the children, what medicines we need to put them on, how much food they need to get. I'll share what I know, the medical knowledge I have. You need to share with me your mastery of this environment and the struggles you're having. And in this way, we build this shared community mastery. Not telling people what to do, not educating them with some vague signs of malnutrition, starvation, which they already probably know, but in fact trying to understand where people are coming from. It is the richest way to do your job. It is the best way to do your job. And it is the way that you actually start to develop friendships. Because you start to have respect for people. Say, wow, you know, you're a fantastic farmer. Like, this is amazing. You know, I don't know if any of you have ever pounded cassava. It is one of the hardest things I've ever done. And I've done it because I wanted to see, you know, these women do it, and it's just this absolute back-breaking labor. And just doing it for 5 or 10 minutes, you have so much respect for the physical strength and coordination and the abilities, right, of these women. And I have some little nerdy knowledge way back here in my brain. It's kind of bogus compared to like crushing that cassava for your family. So we need to take our profession and turn it on its head. You know, if we really want to be healers, we need to be healed. You know, if we want to be healers, we need to be healed of these divisions by reaching out across class, across race, across culture, identity, you know, and that is, I don't think I do it great, right? But we've got to try. We cannot just be observers of the ignorant, right? The myth, I am sick of teaching about the myth of the ignorant mother, whether it's in Ebola or HIV or malnutrition, it's like, just give the mothers more information and they'll do better. You know, I mean, my mom's a great mom, but she is no more or less smart on mothering from the day she had her children than some woman in Liberia. She just had a lot more tools and a lot more agency and a lot more access to medical care and food and housing and a roof over her head, right? So we've got to break out of that myth and be truthful and be honest. And so I think, you know, does this fix our electoral problems? No, but as all of you are in the elite part of this society and the societies that are in your home countries, we have got to reach out. We have got to not be siloed. I mean, I live in a very rich community. My neighbors are rich. I feel uncomfortable. I don't know what I'm going to do about it. But like, we've got to reach across social class and not think that we have all the answers and all the smarts, because that is what's happening. People are making these votes, I believe, out of pain. There's racism, there's all these other things. I don't want to discount that, but that is a pain, and we've created some of that. So those are my sort of thoughts. How do we change that? Well, many of you are actually caregivers. Some of you are nurses, some of you are doctors, you might be medical students, you know, some of you public health personnel too, but I think we need to move from this 30,000 foot analysis to actually caregiving, right? Because when you give care to an individual person, they become a human to you. Right? They're not a number, it's not a data set. And you see their family. Right? You see how they live, you see what they wear, you feel their skin, right? And be caregivers. Don't move away from caregiving in your own family, in your own life, in your own community. And I was telling some
students earlier, you know, I have a neighbor who's a Trump supporter, and he's a very kind of messed up, sad, lonely person. And he's very friendly on our block, you know. And when my mom found out he was a Trump supporter, she was like, I don't think I can talk to him anymore. I said, no. Like, we have to care for our neighbors. Like, that is a value. And whatever makes him be like that, okay, I don't know, but like, he's human, you know, we have to figure out a way to give care in whatever way, we have to be caring people. Because all of us looking at our own Facebook feeds and our own bubble, everyone else falls out and we don't care for them anymore. And we think of them as less than, so caregiving. So now I'm gonna just switch, so that was the stuff I added. I'm going to switch a little bit to sort of our journey at Partners in Health, about talking about universal health coverage, and I want to relate it. I know I was going to say like part A, part B, and they're not related, right? Our view at Partners in Health, we have a very specific motto, mission, which we say make a preferential option for the poor in healthcare. And for us, that starts with caregiving. So it's not a thing of, we have this little bit of money and we're gonna just do this. We say, we have patients, we have people, we have community members, we have our own neighbors and friends and staff in front of us. How is it that we're going to provide care? And one of this, and this is kind of just going back a little bit, was starting HIV treatment. When we started HIV treatment in rural Haiti, it was because our own staff was coming down with HIV. Our own community members in the small community of Haiti, where there were a couple of Americans and mostly Haitians working together, a few people had HIV, and we had the treatment in the United States. We had the treatment in 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 2000, 2001, 2003, and nobody was making it available in any resource poor setting. At the height of the HIV epidemic, there were 8,000 people who died a day of HIV. And none of them were being treated. It was too expensive. Full stop. These are other people undeserving. It's not a rates-based approach. Either you can afford it or you can't. And if you happen to be from a poor country, done. So we started treating people with HIV from 95, actually treating pregnant women, 98, treating people. And my good friend Frene Leon said, it's not, you just start under a tree. Like, you don't have to do a needs assessment. You know, we get taught to do these things that really remove us from proximity. Like, you don't need to do a needs assessment. If you have a person in front of you with HIV, they actually need drugs. Like, done. Like, you don't need to go around the community, do a needs assessment. What do you need? What do you need? What do you need? Like, I didn't need, I'm sick, I need that. So you start under a tree, you know, and you build the program. Right, but it wasn't a program to start out with. It was a caregiving, right? Compassion, and that actually little experiment wasn't an experiment. It wasn't a study. We treated 5 people, then 10, and we used unexpired drugs that were donated by a young man from MIT, who named Sanjay Basu, who was going collecting unexpired HIV drugs and sending them to Haiti. And the Wall Street Journal actually did a story about Sanjay Basu, and they put him on the front page of the Wall Street Journal, and they said, this young man is bringing HIV drugs to Haiti. Why would the Wall Street Journal worry about Sanjay Basu and our 20 rural Haitian peasants? Front page article. Wall Street Journal, not hard, social forces. They did a front page article on this kid. Yeah. No, pharmaceuticals were scared. They were scared that some 19-year-old kid was putting AIDS drugs in a paper bag and bringing them to Haiti to treat peasants. That's crazy. They were worried they would lose their market share. Anyway, we kept doing it. We wrote a little paper, first 50 patients, then 60, then 150, and we said, like, we treat these patients, and they all did well, because as it turns out, they're humans. Humans respond to drugs developed for humans. And we wrote a little article, and we put it in The Lancet, and it was totally trashed by academia. There's no data, you don't have CD4 count, you don't have viral load. We're like, but we have weights. Weight is good, right? And we have pictures. And everybody went back to their job, and their admission criteria was being carried in on a stretcher. So they got better, their ADLs, their activities of daily living. But what happened was, the activists really loved that paper, and they said, wow, if they could do that in Haiti, we can do it in South Africa. If they could do that in Haiti, we can do it in Thailand, we can do it in Uganda, right? And so our little tiny treatment, which came from compassion, came from proximity, came from caring for our own staff, you know, just giving drugs to our own staff, just like, became part of this massive social movement for HIV treatment access. And which culminated in a massive protest in Durban, South Africa in the year 2000, where HIV activists who were so brave, I mean, these people were being killed, you know, in South Africa. They stood proudly with shirts that said, I am HIV positive, and they shut down the conference. That social movement shut down conferences, embarrassed politicians, stopped pharmaceutical board meetings, right? This is looking down and to the left instead of up and to the right for our solutions, right? And it got so crazy that Kofi Annan brought everyone together. He was the head of the UN, called for a special session in 2001 using a bunch of different work, some of which Partners in Health had done with the HIV Equity Initiative, and called for the creation for the Global Fund to fight AIDS, TB, and malaria. Billions of dollars of new money just for the treatment of three diseases, AIDS, TB, and malaria. Prior to that, most health centers look like this. You could go into a health center in rural Africa, and this is what you got. Four meds, a little bit of ORS, people with, you know, telling moms to feed their babies, a lot of, you know, IEC campaigns and stuff. And that changed. That changed not because of science, not because of us, not because of public health. We had all the data for years that this would work. Years. 96, 7, 8, 9, 2000, 1, 2, 3. The thing that changed that was activism, was a social movement, was proximity to the suffering, right? Not a bunch of modeling exercises. Not to say we shouldn't do the modeling exercises. I love modeling exercises. I use them all the time. My entire life is a modeling exercise. Like, not this kind, but, you know, they're good, but you have to stay close to the ground. So all the research is important. It helps us, it moves us forward, but we have to stay close to the ground. So, the weird thing that happened to us at Partners in Health is we didn't actually care about HIV. Like, we treated HIV out of a moral imperative because we're caregivers, right? We were never an HIV organization. So we got the HIV money and we said, okay, that's good, but there are people with TB, there are women who are having obstetrical emergencies, there are people with broken legs. Like, they all need care. Health is a basic right. So, and we came across these clinics that looked like horrible. So we said, what if we use the HIV money to revitalize primary healthcare? What if we use the HIV money to put in essential drugs, to reduce barriers to care, to clean these places up and make them dignified, to hire and pay the staff, because often the staff hadn't been paid in 9 or 10 months, right? Because the governments are so broke, which I probably won't have time to go into the brokenness of governments at this late hour when I've been up all night watching Donald Trump win the presidency. So we said, okay, we're gonna do that. We're gonna put drugs, pay staff, clean these places up, hire and pay and train an army of community health workers to bring people to clinic, and we're gonna provide care. And by the way, we'll offer them an HIV test. And if they have HIV, we will treat them. And in a couple years, we found everyone who had HIV, and we found lots of people with TB, and we found a lot of people with broken legs, and we provided lots of healthcare. And these places that had no demand, right, went from seeing 0 patients a day to 250 patients a day. We didn't have to do any demand creation. We didn't have to punch anyone in the stomach and make them sick so they'd come forward. They all came forward once we delivered care. So we started to realize that the idea of universal health coverage, which all of you should know is part of our next set of metrics globally, the Sustainable Development Goals, right? The universal health coverage means something, right? And we need to decide what it means, because right now, the people we're deciding are bankers. Just telling you. And some of them are our friends, like Jim Kim, who's the founder of Partners in Health, who's now president of the World Bank. But many of the people talking about universal health coverage, even here in the United States, where we don't talk about health as a right, and please someone take that on, because I'm not good at that, but like, we need to do that. But universal health coverage is about coverage and health. It's not just about financing, right? So you hear people say, we got to finance this, we got to finance that. But if you finance that rotten clinic, you're still not going to cover the population. So we started to really figure out, how do we get people the services they need? And one great thing that happened to us during this HIV period of expansion at PIH is we made a conscious effort that we weren't going to do any more work in a charity clinic. We're only going to support the public sector. Because we knew the public sector in poor countries had been bankrupt for years. Just like the public sector in the United States, just like the infrastructure in all those red states, it's being bankrupt and people get mad, right? And so we said, we're going to use our efforts to rebuild public infrastructure. So all of the work we did was in the public sector. The good thing, when you're in a public clinic, is you know how many people you serve. Because it's arranged that way. So you're in a clinic, and they say, oh, your clinic takes care of these five villages, and that's 20,000 people. So you know the denominator, and you can start talking about public and population health. So we said, oh, okay, we have 20,000 people, HIV prevalence is X, that means we have this many HIV patients, we have this many TB patients, we have this many pregnant women. How do we actually design a system that will provide healthcare for all of those people? And that's how we talk about universal health coverage. So we started doing that, because before that, like, nobody knows. I'm gonna skip over some of this since I went into the... I'm just gonna say that until the Global Fund and PEPFAR, most poor countries had $5 per capita to spend on health. And that was a legacy of structural adjustment, the World Bank, the IMF, the shrinking of the public sector, big government bad, private sector good. Does any of that sound familiar? Big government bad, private sector good, big government corrupt, private sector good. And so all of that public commons, health and education, was gutted. Especially in sub-Saharan Africa, parts of Latin America, poor countries like Haiti, Cambodia, other places like that, okay? So most places prior to the Global Fund had $5 per capita. So with $5 per capita, you cannot do anything in health. You can't actually do anything. So the idea of growth monitoring, as I talked about before, oral rehydration, IEC campaigns, some vaccination, that fits in your $5 package. And I've done this exercise now for many years with health professionals from developing countries, right? And we get to this $5 package and they start doing, and these are people, this is how they live, like they know it on one level, but they don't know why it is like that, right? And then they try to start making their health plans and they're like, oh my God, and then the ambulance, I said, no, we have no ambulance. For $5 per capita, you have no ambulance, you have no fuel, you have no driver, right? Even that health center I was showing you, Plebo, I found out recently that health center was never actually built by the government. It was donated by a private citizen because she wanted a health center in her community of 65,000 people. And so it wasn't even built as a health center, and there's no money for maintenance, and as things fall apart, they fall apart because you have $5 per capita. So the thing that the Global Fund changed was that paradigm. But if you then only use it for HIV, you're wasting this enormous opportunity to provide healthcare for people. So this is, you know, what we found in Haiti. This is the clinic, Las Cabas Clinic. This just gives you an idea of the kind of underutilization thingy, and people demand this and that, demand creation is all bull bullshit. Population 55,000, seroprevalence 5%, TB incidence ought to be 250,000 per 100,000, so you should at least find 125 cases of TB in a year. Right, that's incidence. You guys know, you're public health people, incidence means yearly, right? So TB case, you would anticipate in this case 137 cases, but instead, the year before we started, they found 9. How could you even say you could achieve universal health coverage? Like, you cannot. So you can finance that system to find 9 cases a year. And this is what's happened to us at Partners in Health all over the place, because as we set up systems that can actually address the burden of disease, we immediately outstrip the government procurement, because they are designed to treat 9 cases a year. Right? So you have to have a predictive model. So this is what I was telling you, that we, in these public clinics with global fund money, just doing those 4 things, staff, supply chain, reducing barriers, and community health workers, we went from seeing 20 patients a day to 400 a day. 0 patients a day to 150 patients a day. But then you've got to figure out, okay, how many drugs do you need? What staff do you need? What infrastructure? You're going to have to build toward that. And it becomes overwhelming for the staff, because day in and day out, they're seeing more and more patients. They're like used to not doing anything, like over here, right? And then suddenly, like, we didn't randomize for the rainbow colored awning. So maybe it was just that, but I don't think so. Suddenly the staff's like really overwhelmed, right? So, you know, how much is more? This same thing happened in Rwanda, where we took over from a non-governmental organization that had been working for 2 years in rural Rwanda, you know, with millions of dollars of global fund money, and in the area we were, they found 2 HIV cases. No, sorry, 6. 6 HIV cases in 2 years. 6. Okay? And what did they say? People don't want to come forward because of stigma. It is not in their culture, right? They prefer traditional healers. That's that horrible, deplorable kind of health center I showed. So it was all put the blame on culture, put the blame on people. So we said, yeah, fine, we'll do it. They said, no, it's really hard. There's a lot of stigma in this area. They, you know, it's probably because they really believe in spirits and voodoo, and there's a crazy elephant and all kinds of stuff. The hippos, maybe it's the hippos. So we built a health system. Drugs, staff, infrastructure improvements, community health workers, diminish the barriers. And you can see that in the first 6 months we were there, we had found, you know, enrolled 700 patients on therapy. Same place that over a 2-year period had 6. Because they had made this mistake of being in this view of not really working with the community. So we worked on this in many places, and we showed that not only could we integrate HIV testing in better primary care, find all the HIV cases, as I told you, but we also saw that things like vaccination services went up. Right? Because if you build healthcare, then people come forward. So it's not that, again, that people believe in voodoo or whatever. They might, but they can still get vaccinated. Antenatal clinic attendance in Malawi. Maternal facility-based delivery, which is the hardest thing, right? Because you got women who have to get there before they get in labor, they have to stay sometimes overnight. You know, it's like a much more complicated thing than getting a shot, right? And we said, wow, you know, we saw that these places over a year would do 40 or 50 deliveries, and in just 1 year of designing the system to achieve universal coverage, right, designing the supply chain, the staff, the whatever, listening to the community, how far can you walk, what supports do you need, how is it that you can come in advance, we could triple even in just 1 year the facility-based delivery. But how much is a lot more? That's a question. This was 350% more in 1 year, just from designing things toward the burden of disease. Right? Rather than using this cultural yada yada and saying people aren't going to come, we said, let's give them a shot. Let's do what needs to be done and see if they'll come. And of course, they did. 350. So we started working to try to say, well, every year we keep seeing more. When does this stop? And we sort of put out the hypothesis that maybe it stops when you achieve universal health coverage. Like maybe it stops when you, it doesn't stop, but it like reaches a plateau when you have provided the services that the community needs with the proper number of nurses and doctors and community health workers and the right infrastructure. And so we started to set some targets and figure that out. And Lesotho particularly was very interested in this because they have one of the worst health systems in the world, and they actually spend some money on health. They spend about $120 per capita, so not a super poor country. But they had no idea how to deliver services to really address the burden of disease. So we set up these targets based on the population, plus the, you know, what we knew to be the disease burden, and then designing the delivery side to address that burden of disease. And what we showed was just a massive increase in, for example, facility-based delivery. And I'm not going to go into great detail, but I want to show you this slide, and then I'm going to just sort of wrap up so we have a little time for questions. This was a whole district, so we're now trying to do this in Lesotho for a whole, actually the whole country. We've been asked to reform the health system for the entire country of Lesotho on this delivery side, supply side model. Figure out the targets, design the system, put the staff in, and shockingly, people come forward, right? So this is one district called Mahalitsuk, 73, in a district of 250,000, okay? There were 73 facility-based births before the reform. And this is a place in the world, this is one of the top five countries for maternal mortality. 1,100 women die in childbirth per 100,000. So women are dying all the time in childbirth. 73 are coming forward. Every once in a while, you know, it's you know, chiefs and spirits and all this, and then we built it. So we saw this massive increase. But here's the scary thing. That's only 34% of what's really needed, right? So we have so much more to do. If we believe that healthcare is a human right, that people have need access to care, that even if we design these systems, we still have to do more. Like 34%, I would say, in 1 year from almost zero is amazing, and that's great. And I'm so proud of the work our team has done in being the midwives for this. But that's year one, and I want us to get to 100% facility-based delivery year on year so we have eyes on women, and then also work on the quality of care so that when they're there again, they're getting good care, and then make sure that they have emergency obstetrical care if they need C-sections or blood, right? This is how we need to do our work. And we have learned so much from the HIV movement, because in the HIV movement, you cannot have this discussion, any discussion, without people living with HIV in the room. Any talk about funding, any talk about project design, any talk about anything, you have people living with HIV in the room at the highest levels, at the grassroots levels. And that changes everything. That proximity. And I think as professionals, we need to demand that kind of proximity. So since I took some time to talk about where we are as a profession, I'll just wrap up by saying, you know, all of this, universal health coverage is a laudable goal, our proximity is a laudable goal, but we need to rethink our mentality of expertise, of education, and really rework our values to be much more proximate to the suffering. If we wanna kind of broker a world that's gonna be fairer, and you know, we could give up some of our laurels and be closer to the grassroots, and that, you know, I'm super proud to work with a phenomenal team of people who are doing just that, from community health workers to physicians to drivers and cooks and cleaners who I call my friends, so I'll stop there. Thank you.
We can fit in a couple questions, I think. We've got a couple mics down here in the shadows, in the corners, if anyone's willing to venture there and give us a couple questions.
People are still too stunned.
from yesterday.
Yeah.
Joia Mukherjee. My name is Andy of Joia. I'm sorry. I knew that actually. I met you actually in April at the Social Medicine Consortium.
Oh, yes. I didn't sing this time.
I know. I was actually expecting
that. But I was wearing red also. Yeah.
I really appreciate the talk. It definitely beat walking around the School of Nursing and weeping all day, because that's what I always spend my day. I had a question, and that was very specific to Maryland, and I know you are more globally focused. Maryland has incentive money for people who do primary care, and they hit certain measures. For example, if their blood pressure is well controlled, if they note antiarrhythmics, they note whatever, and they get certain amounts of money. And I work in a hospital in Bel Air, Maryland, called Upper Chesapeake. It's quite white. It is quite anti-brown, and I happen to be not a man or white. And so I see a lot of pushback against this kind of structure of good primary care. So when the delivery is good, when the delivery is mandated to be good, how do you come up against this neoliberal kind of positive notion? You know, how do you take the burden of health off the markets?
I think it's a great question. I don't have a lot of expertise, but what I would say, in my lack of domestic expertise, but maybe some expertise in sort of community health, and I think we've got to involve patients more. I don't see a lot of movement on the left that involves community. And so, people are bemoaning this or that incentive, but where are the patient groups? Where are the advocates? We've got to figure out, again, proximity. We're sort of in this lauded position of how we're gonna get compensated. The earnest discussions with community, and there's a nascent movement called Article 25 that's working on the right to health in a lot of different countries, and it's, focused on patients and caregiving and I don't even think we call them consumers of healthcare. Are you a consumer of your right? So I think we've got to reach out and organize with people, families, communities who are receiving care and try to figure out, how do we become part of that community? I know that's a really big reach, but I think the current dialogue is never gonna get us beyond the market model of the consumer and the, but I'm very naive about this.
Quick follow up also. So I'm in the School of Nursing, and it's kind of well known in the Social Medicine Consortium that I rejected medical school and went to School of Nursing instead, for the reason I'm more interested in social determinants of health.
Yeah.
And I didn't see it as an opportunity. So how do we become partners as doctors and nurses and public health practitioners and pharmacists and social workers and make a team-based approach to health? Because I think that's also part and parcel of why the incentive money is like.
Interdisciplinary work is really, I'm having a little hard time hearing that microphone, but interdisciplinary, I gotcha, I think. Interdisciplinary work is really important, but I think, again, it can't be like the interdisciplinary professionals with no patients in that mixed. And, I think in the 60s and 70s, there was a movement for community-oriented primary care. It didn't go as far as it needs to go. We need to revitalize that. I think nurses have a particular role to play. I was just talking to a colleague about that today, because nurses actually are less elite. The nursing profession is much more social class integrated, and so I think it's an important platform to really mobilize from. I mean, doctors are kind of universally from an elite social strata, so I think we need to make common cause with our nursing colleagues, our paramedic colleagues, and even many of our nurse assistants, many of them are immigrants. How do we make common cause across those professions? It's really important, and I think nursing has a really important leadership role to play in that. Yes, we should just be doctors, we ought to just be the technical sort of servants in the stone soup mix. Yeah.
So I apologize, because I think most of us are really sort of still in election land, but I'd like to ask you a question that's more related to your work in Africa, actually.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, with the slide you showed on in-hospital deliveries, has there been any work to actually keep deliveries in the community, but just train community level providers to recognize high risk births and send them to the hospital.
Yeah, it's a good question. The answer is yes, and unfortunately it doesn't work. And I'll tell you why. So, you know, home birth, that, you know, the movement for sort of home birth here is a really big privilege. And we're privileged because we have proximity to hospitals. But the problem with maternal mortality is you cannot predict the risk. Some women are high risk, right? But most women who have obstetrical emergencies, it comes out of left field. So you cannot predict those women. So you need to have eyes on. And part of the problem is if you have a problem in rural Lesotho and you are a 10-hour walk in the snow from a health facility, you're gonna die. Right? So it just not, most of the investments between 1960 and probably around the turn of 2000, turn of the millennium, were training traditional birth attendants to do better. And it failed to improve maternal mortality because of the problem with emergency obstetrical care and the problem that you cannot predict who needs it. So we've got to get these women to facilities. Once everyone has great access to medical care, yeah, maybe we can think about then home births. But the problem with home birth when you don't have access to high level obstetrical care is you don't have access to high level obstetrical care. Yeah. Yes.
Hello. Huge fan, so happy to hear you talk. Thank you. I'm a social worker. I provide mental health services to homeless adults here in Baltimore. And I am very down with the Freirean analysis and application to direct practice. And what I found is that when you talk about like housing as a human right with clients, it reduces the burden of guilt and shame and self-loathing. As a way to, you know, build partnership and also just reduce the burden of disease. But if you look, I feel like if you look at the social movements like civil rights and LGBT rights and women's rights and disability rights, you know, the movements that have like gotten policy change done, it was always the directly affected people that got the change done. And so, you know, I feel like we as service providers, like as the ones that are gifted and privileged to have the analysis, need to be the ones activating the directly affected people that we serve.
Helping them, yep.
But you can't do that without talking about politics, both in the clinical encounter and at work with your colleagues. And I feel like both medically and even in social work, we try to be apolitical. And that's because politics is taboo. Structural conditions are taboo. So how do you move past that?
Yeah, I mean, until we get all our civil liberties away, I would say no one's gonna stop you from being political. I mean, they might try, but and maybe get fired. But look, there's no way you can look at, I mean, and I'm just saying the same thing you are, because we're fans, right? But I mean, there's no way you can take care of homeless people and not see that as political. Right? It's fictitious to say it's not political. And in fact, I mean, this is one of my favorite Freirean quotes, right? He says, you cannot be neutral in the face of oppression lest you side with the oppressor, right? So professing neutrality in that situation is siding with the oppressive forces, the social forces. So we've got to do that, and I think you're right. We've got to figure out ways as providers to support groups. I'll tell you one beautiful example that just happened recently. I was so proud of these medical students of mine. You know, I'm claiming them as my own. I have no ownership of them. But, you know, they wanted to figure out how to sort of help bridge some class divides. And there was a set of workers at Harvard that were striking over their health care. And our medical students, some of them, help them figure out, you know, they used, again, the stone soup thing. They had some expertise in health insurance, right? These people had expertise in their working conditions. They came together, they said, like, how can we help you? Help us understand our health benefits and how we might structure better benefits. So these students actually lend their specific thing to this movement. They don't have to, like, take on the whole ownership of it, right? But they were useful to
that movement. So I think that's the way I see organizing from our standpoint, is like, how do we, you know, look, if you want to storm the barricades, I'm all for it, but obviously. But I also think we have a set of skills that can be useful to people who are struggling, and we can be allies in that. And you know, whether the struggle is our own or just that we're allies. So thank you for your work, it's great. Yeah.
Hi, sorry. So my name is Sarah. I work for the Center for American Indian Health here at Bloomberg. And you spoke a lot about the ways in which you guys work in areas where you've come in and have heard a lot of negative speak about culture and that being a barrier to health. And I'm just kind of curious if you guys are planning on ways to kind of integrate culture into the healthcare that you guys are providing in these areas.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a great question. You know, we do work actually in Navajo and Rosebud, and I think it's very different when you're working with a community and they say our culture is this, right? Than when you're the expert and you accuse culture of being the barrier, right? So I want to make that very clear. Culture is very important. You know, how people understand the world, how they prioritize things, like that's extremely important. But it has to come from the affected people. You know, I'm very interested, for example, in our Navajo, you know, work with the Navajo community, you know, in how they see their elderly, right? And they see the elderly in the community as needing special protection, and they put a lot of support services, very different than white American culture, in my opinion, right? Putting a lot of their social support toward these, what they call their vulnerable elderly. So that, but that's coming from them. That's not coming from me saying Native American culture doesn't do X, right? So that's all I'm saying. I'm not saying culture isn't there. I'm saying it is not our job to use culture as a kind of barrier against people's sort of achieving of health. But if we're proximate, then we hear the cultural concerns, we hear the gendered concerns. You know, in Lesotho, the example I gave of people coming forward and, you know, delivering babies in the facility, it was actually the mothers-in-law that we had to talk to, right? That was the culture. And we heard that from the women, right? We heard that from the women, the community members. So we had group meetings of mothers-in-law because they're in charge of the household, so they had to kind of give permission. But it would have been stupid for us to say, okay, it's not Basotho culture to deliver. So they're different, right? We kind of wrap it up. You announce, and I think we have...
All right, it looks like we have a few more questions, but we want to be respectful of your time and just let you know that Dr. Mukherjee will be available afterward to discuss and take some more questions from you guys personally. But also before we wrap up, I just wanted to send out a couple words of gratitude really quick before we let you guys go to the reception. We have a special thanks to Scott Price, who's runs the sound and AV here, and without his help, we of course wouldn't be able to function in this whole room, so special thanks for that. We also have a couple heroes in our audience today who answered our desperate calls 20 minutes before this event when our videographer canceled, Nathan Muir and Alan Chan, who are taking video for us today so that the people who weren't able to be here can still take part and see what's going on. Of course, we'd like to acknowledge the generous support of Dean Ziegelstein and his Office of the Vice Dean of Education. With your support, Dean Ziegelstein, us students in the Hopkins Distinguished Speaker Series are able to have the ability to bring people together and get great speakers like Dr. Mukherjee to share ideas and foster discussion. And of course, none of this would be possible without the support of the Johns Hopkins University Alumni Association and the Medical Student Senate. And of course, finally, I need to send a very warm thank you to Dr. Mukherjee for traveling here today to give us this important message and give us some words that I think we all really needed to hear today. Thank you.